with the introduction of Dr. Al-Marabi, I think I kind of start. Just feel free to ask anything you want, because we are a few, and it's better if you ask in the moment. We will cover four major topics. First one is an introduction to what's a speckle. And with this speckle, we find something that are very singularities. And we will see how to model them mathematically and how to use them in some sample applications. And then we will focus our attention on our case study, that is paint drying evaluation. First, I want to split the light in two main phenomena description. One is coherent light, and the other one is incoherent light. The coherent light is that can be modeled at a given point or at a given time, because it won't change if you keep the space or time. I mean, when a laser travels through the space, in each of the planes that the light is traveling, you can actually know what's the function that this particular light has in each of these planes. But if you have, like, the cell phone flashlight, you see that you can have this kind of behavior in this type of light. So laser is coherent light because you can model it and you can predict at a given point of space or at a given time what's the function of this light. And incoherent phenomena, it's more difficult to model mathematically. Even it's possible, but is not a really good use of it. So within the coherent light, we have a phenomenon that is called a speckle. And a speckle is just the superposition of different points as small radiators, as we will see here briefly, that they superpose over a surface, creating an interference pattern. This interference pattern is random, and it looks like this. I have a really small diffuser. And as you can see, I hope that you can see it in the wall, you see that there are small pieces of light that are moving, because I'm shaking. I have a really big problem of tremor in my hands. But if I move the laser over the surface, the pattern of the light changes. But if I do it with incoherent light, You can see anything. You see, that's the main difference between these two types of light. Then we will focus on let me turn off the we will focus on the coherent phenomena, and in particular with the speckle phenomena. In this speckle, you can have a complex field. That means that you can have a phase and an intensity, and actually have a function of this kind of field. You can record a speckle with a camera by two means. One is you have the reference beam that is coherent light from laser, and it can transmit over a diffusive surface like the one we saw previously, but also by reflection you can record some speckled patterns. But in reality, we can actually record complex field. We just only record intensities and try to sort out with a mathematical modeling to have a complex field as in the sense of the physical phenomena, or just assign a pseudo complex field by means of transformation. If we want to do it first, with the actual complex field of light, we use the Fresnel transform that looks like this, where you have an input plane and an output plane, and each point, P sub zero from the output plane, is formed by the superposition of all the contributions from the input plane. So what we are doing here with this integral is just adding all the contributions from the input plane onto the output plane, and we put some phase terms just to see how the light travels from the point A to the point B, and it have to accomplish some description of the model. So with this, when you have this complex plane, we have points where we don't have light. What happened in those particular points? In those particular points, it's actually probable to obtain a phase singularity. A phase singularity are those particular places with, that are points that can be located with arbitrary precision, at least in theory, where the intensity is null. And if the intensity is absolutely null, you can have a phase where there's no light. So the phase is undefined and the intensity is null. How we describe this kind of phase singularities in our complex field? Well, we obtain the real and imaginary part from field. And in those places where the real part is equal to zero and the imaginary part is equal to zero, and we cross those control lines, in this point we have a singularity, with the particularity that the phase around that point, it behaves as an ellipse and have all the topological properties of an ellipse. And we can recognize those properties and actually characterize our singularities based on the core structural properties of the phase around that point. So the phase singularities are present in our speckle fields. Here we have a speckle pattern, we have the intensity and we have the phase. And we, as this is a complex field, we can obtain the real and imaginary part. From the real and imaginary part, we obtain our control lines for the value zero, and then cross all these control lines to localize the phase singularities. What's the advantage? The advantage is that if you have some points in our speckle that are precisely located and have properties, you don't have to be concerned for the whole image, but just keep track of these particular points. This is how it looks in a simulation. We have phase singularities located at this phase map. It's a 2P modulo phase map. And in the super zoom where we saw the pixels, we have a circulation over a certain point that can be clockwise or counterclockwise. And we have values from 0 to 255 that we can actually see that circulate over that point in either both directions. So I tell you that we have the location with a arbitrary precision, at least theoretically, but we also have the properties. It's an ellipse. As it is an ellipse, we can use the stock parameters, and we can locate each of the singularities by tracking the properties of the ellipse in a Poincaré sphere. As you can see here, we have different red points, each one of those corresponding to a phase singularity, and we can then track them and search them and use them to process our images. So, as I told you before, we can use these phase singularities as markers, and we only have to preserve the information from phase singularities, and we don't have to deal with the whole image to do the processing. So what's the problem? The problem is that with a CCD camera or the conventional camera, you can't record complex field. I mean, there's some techniques that are devoted to recover the phase, but we want to do something fast and something that can be usable in some applications. So instead of dealing with Fresnel transform, we deal with the Lager-Gauss transform that is not actually modeling the real phase from field, but assigning a complex field from an intensity registry. So we have the Fourier transform of our CCD recorded image. We multiply it by a filter function that is in this way, where the intensity looks like a donut, that actually if you cut it, are two Gaussians that just revolve against in a point, and we have a spiral phase plate in the in the phase. With this, what we are doing, it's a convolution filter to assign a complex field to an intensity recording. And we can track in this complex field that we obtain singularities and process them as if they were obtained with the actual phase from complex field. So this takes us to some sample applications of what to do with your singularities. Well, as I show you with the diffuser, we have a laser that illuminates a diffuser where I put a pupil aperture mask. If I move this and record it in an output plane, then I will see that the whole speckle pattern will move as the diffuser is moving. If the pupil aperture mask and the diffuser are moving together, we can see that the speckle pattern will move all together without change, or at least without local change. That's because if the whole surface is illuminated by laser, it's the same surface moving over space. But if we detach the mask from the diffuser and move one respectively the other, some points of the diffuser are going in your aperture and some points of the diffuser are going out. So what you are expecting is that the speckle patterns change over time. So we have two situations. One, it's pretty ideal where all the speckle patterns move together, and the other one is where you have the correlation effect. And this will affect the measurements in a displacement application. So
are those actual video images or are those your reconstructions?
This is actual speckle patterns recorded in Argentina. I just made a GIF in MATLAB with different frames.
Okay.
So we have two photos of two states. One is before displacement, and the other one is after displacement. And I find and calculate the core structural properties from phase singularities in both images. Then, if I try to pair these phase singularities by following not following any rule, they will just be pairs of anything with anything, and everybody will be with everybody, and I will not be able to measure anything. But if I just said, okay, I find this phase singularity that correspond with this particular LX that has these particular properties, and I want to find something similar in the next pattern, and I can do a pairing of two different phase singularities, one from the image one that was before displacement, and one from the image two that was after displacement. And then what we do is we do an histogram of all the measurements made between the pairs. In this case, we have a perfectly correlated displacement, well, with a little of the correlation due to of electronical noise in the CCD or something like that. But we have a really, really narrow peak in our histogram. Here we perform a 2-pixel displacement that corresponds to 16 microns. And in X and in Y, we try to not don't move the system. Then with this peak, you get an insight of which was the displaced distance, and we can set a range where we are going to look for our pair of similar phase singularities. With this processing, we obtain this kind of histograms, one for X, one for Y, and we have a standard deviation that it's in the region of 10 at minus 5, that it's a really, really good measurement. But what happened if the pupil aperture moves not jointly to the diffuser? Well, we get a more complicated situation, but still we can measure. As you can see, we don't have this narrow peak that the narrow peak that, we have on the correlated pattern, and when we try to do our narrow searching of phase singularities, we get not as well behaved histograms as we can per less phase singularities, because if the speckle pattern change, the phase singularities will change also. And it lead to standard bigger standard deviation, and the measurement is not as good as it was with the undecorrelated case. But we have plenty of applications. We will cover some fast. We can do pattern recognition as it is a convolutive filter. It will have only one response for a function. So we can track and characterize each of the phase singularities. And if this girl take a picture, I can try not to match features from image, but just try to match the phase singularities that I'm expecting to appear in the image. Another application is image filtering. Here we have the picture of a cell, and we want to do an edge detector. As it's a convolutive filter, and it's isotropic, a line will attach to each of the edges from image. And it works pretty good in this purpose.
I probably missed the very beginning of your talk. Are you starting with an intensity image and then actually representing it in the computer as phase?
Yeah.
Is that what you're doing? And then you're looking for the singularities of that phase image?
I'm starting with an intensity image. And what I'm doing is by means of an integral transform assigning a pseudo-complex field to this particular intensity image.
Okay.
That as it has to follow with the impulse response kind of situation, it will have only one response for a particular function.
Okay, so that was that big integral you had earlier.
Yeah.
And that converts an intensity image into a complex value.
Yeah.
Function.
Yeah, but if you want to be really precise, it must be a pseudo-complex field, because it's not an actual complex field. It's just an analytical function made of an intensity or a real value function.
Okay,
it has some properties.
By pseudo-complex, you just mean that it's a computer representation.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's not
it's
real
complex in numbers. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. Also, we can track dynamic events. As you can see here, we have a simulation where we follow three different geometrical shapes by means of following the phase singularities. These trajectory lines that are marked here, I don't know if you see it well, have sub-pixel resolution. As you can locate this particular point within a complex field, you can also do it at least theoretically arbitrary precision. And here we have an styrofoam ball over a driver where we put a signal to the driver, and the styrofoam start to move randomly as the time passes. And we track the phase singularities from this styrofoam ball. Well, what we are talking today is, and it's our case study, it's paint drying. As you can see, we have many applications with phase singularities, but in particularly, we can track dynamic events. Paint drying for our eyes is something that is standing still, but actually there is a lot of activity there. There is a huge interest in know how the coating of a surface is made. You have the car industry, you have wall painting, you have impervious coatings, you have many things that require that you don't have defects in your coating, and also to check how am I doing my coating, right? For example, if you have a car line and you want to paint a car, how much time, what's the minimum time you have to wait to apply a second layer? If you optimize these times, so you're saving money. So as you can touch the paint, well, you can paint that away and touch it, but if you want to actually know if the paint is drying without damaging your work, you have to find a non-contact measurement from painting. What's our scheme? Well, we have a pre-process stage where we take the images from CCD and just do some kind of filtering to remove electronical noise and other kind of stuff in the image. Then we assign a complex film by means of the Lagrange-Gauss transform. With this complex field, what we do is phase singularity location and the recognition of the core structure properties from those phase singularities. Then we can track them, or we can do many things with them, but in particular in this case, track them, and then evaluate our model to see if they are actually doing what it has to do. So what we have here is a really, really simple setup where we have a CCD camera and a lens and a laser, and we have paint. The camera is perpendicular, respectively the paint, and we just record the activity from a speckle. This is how the activity of a speckle look. We have here a time zero situation where you just apply the paint, and the speckle patterns start to boil. If you have a little imagination, you can see that this looks really similar to water boiling in a pot. And as the time passes by and the paint starts to dry, you see that you will have less and less activity, and the speckle will start to be still in time. So what we can do with this is just record a video or record a set of images that start with time zero and go to time n, and we just take a line. Why just take a line? Because due to the properties of a speckle, if you have the measurement of a line, you have the measurement of everything. It's an ergodic system. So we just need a line, and we can have properties from each of the image. With this line, we can set up a new image that will be called activity image. You know, you can do this by software, but also you can do it with analog devices. In particular, this is a single pixel detector, single array detector, that it's really good for this purpose. Why? Because the signal-to-noise ratio is really good, it's 2,000 to 1, and you have a huge range in the detector. And you can do many, many frames per second, 900 frames per second, because you are just processing one line of pixels, not an array of pixels as you do in conventional CCD cameras. And with this, you can acquire your activity image and then process them. What happened? If you are just recording a line and you are putting it together, with this activity images, what you have is an activity history over time in your image. If you see at the very beginning, we don't have really horizontal lines as we have at the end, but we have a lot of little speckles in the image. And as the time is passing, the speckles start to stand still, and at the end it will be the same each frame. So what you get is an horizontal line. What you do conventionally, or what it's reported to do conventionally with the speckle measurement, it's to find the coherence matrix to evaluate how much are the pixels changing in respect with the neighbors in the horizontal direction, right? So what we are proposing is we have our activity images. This for us will be a new intensity image. And we will assign a complex field by means of the Lagrange-Gauss transform, and we'll have an intensity and phase. From those intensity and phase, we can find the phase singularities and track them over the activity images. What we are taking into account is not the location, not the properties, but the density of phase singularities. Because as the pattern change more phase singularities will appear, it is more probable to have zero intensity locations in the image. But if you have just lines, it will be less the probability to have zero intensity location in the image. And with this with this similarities, we keep just a number for each activity image, and we put it all, put them all together. As a matter of fact, when you have T0 time, you have a lot of dislocations on face, but those dislocations are less probable to appear as the image is standing still. At the end, you will end with a very well-behaved face because it's just horizontal lines. With this, we can calculate which is the content or what's the activity of our paint in time. The average weight loss, this blue line, it's measured by weighting the painting, and it corresponds with the actual ground truth of the system. The orange line is the optical signal by means of a speckle dynamics that is the proposed in the literature. But our proposal with phase singularities fit really well with the ground truth. And we are just taking into account how many phase singularities are in an activity image. This result were obtained with a wet film thickness of 150 microns at a room temperature of 25 Celsius and with a relative humidity of 60%. This data is important because, as you know, the paint drying takes into account the humidity, the temperature, the diffusion of liquid in the medium and the evaporation of the solvent of the surface.
And how much was the time? The time from the first frame until the end frame, how much is the time?
Yeah, and this particular graphic, it's from 27 minutes to 50 minutes. I just cropped the other results because one, you have a lot of activity at the beginning because the content of water, of solvent in the paint is so high, and it starts to approach to a value. It's not precisely zero because the weight won't be zero, the count of phase density, phase singularities won't be zero, but it correlates with the ground truth model. Well, in conclusion, when optical and digital techniques are combined, you can do non-contact assessment of paint drying and other kind of applications. Paint drying by means of phase singularities, we foresee that is a good way of measuring the wetness of the paint. And we are currently evaluating this result that I present you today was for the general drying over a region. But our question is it possible to actually measure local drying of paint? Because if you can do so, you can control more accurately if the painting is drying homogeneously or if the pigments are well distributed over the solvent and many things. And that's it, thank you. Any question?
I think we have time for questions. Please ask him. Any questions?
So the time is 27 minutes to
50.
50. Mm-hmm. And how many frames? How many?
For each, for each one of these points, you have 500 frames. And these 500 frames are recorded over 3 seconds.
For anyone who actually did this job, it depends, like drying paint, it depends on the paint itself, mm-hmm. It depends on the surface you have, like if the surface was treated and marked, something like that. So the time or the drying of paint depends on many, many factors. It's not that simple, you know, just to actually generalize. But I understand that you are looking at
actually, the purpose is not to describe how the drying of the paint is modeled, but to actually track this drying phenomena over time. And this is a tool to track the change, not to model the phenomena.
I think there is a paint company involved in this.
There are two companies involved in Argentina. One is Loci and the other one is Pinturas Ortiz. That can be more Spanish.
Other
question?
Yeah, I was actually could go back to your slide. The girl that you convert, you did the Gauss-Weber transform on. I'm just trying to understand what it is what exactly you're doing, because you're not directly taking speckle patterns, you're even processing speckle patterns to...
No, here I'm...
Well, no, in the other, but here, you've got phase singularities. Okay, so here you have this color image. Did you do a Gauss-Weber on a color image, or did you do it on a grayscale image? Did you convert that to grayscale?
No, I converted to a grayscale. Then with this grayscale, I assume that the girl photo is a function. And then transform it by means of the integral transformer, obtain the phase singularities.
So you have these phase singularities, and then what do you think? Do you think there's some significance in processing like face images or recognizing humans that this provides an advantage on?
Yeah, I was when I did this result set of results. I was thinking in the next thing. You have a lot of people in a registry. You don't want to record all the image from people,
yeah,
but just on particular points. As the linear transformer are invariant to displacement and to rotation, you just can if you can guarantee that you will take the picture of this person at the same distance, you can just keep track of this particular point and just save this particular point, not the whole image.
Okay. Well, there's other transforms that would allow you to do scaling variables too, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you could modify, maybe make some kind of modified thing. So how does the Gauss-Weber give you phase from a real image? I might have missed that. It was, you had a donut-shaped intensity, but what, or is that a donut-shaped phase?
This filter has two stages. One is intensity that will...
Oh, that's the phase of it below.
Below. That it will, this part will assign the complex part to the kernel of filter. Yeah.
I think Dr. Cantor did share
the question. Yeah, even analyzing the paint through image, obviously, you are trying to analyze the process in time domain.
Mm-hmm.
What are the changes? Did you think about other potential applications? Because in other domains, maybe there are some of these changes, mm-hmm, you can record these changes.
Yeah,
the other domains.
There are several applications that all fall into cliche, because actually you can measure the grass growth or measure activities in seeds, or measure biological processes that are really slow, but you want to get an actual measure in time of that process. For example, imagine that you have some seeds from many, many years before. How you know that these seeds are alive? You just have to plant them, mm-hmm, and expect that something go up. But you can actually put a coherent light illumination and track over a small period of time if the seed is actually moving. Because when the seeds are alive, they are not standing still, in a sense. That's some of the
ideas. We need questions from the students.
Just like you mentioned at the very beginning in your framework that you start with the key processing. So I just was wondering what kind of like some,
yeah,
kind of histogram equalization, bias correction, or something like that, or just your images follow a normal distribution and good lines?
No. First, you have to enhance contrast, because the sort of sensor that you are using to measure speckle activity this speckle will change over time really fast and you won't get track of it. And the second part that we are doing of pre-processing is that we want to be sure that all the information that we have within the phenomena is actually is possible to obtain the transform of that information. I mean, if you have electronic noise in your recording and you apply this kind of transformation over that particular image, you will sense the electronic noise of the image. So you, what I do with this is I do a Gaussian filter to just to make it smooth.
Yeah. Another question, please. When you take like these lines from the different speckles and combine them together into one image, the image, did you transpose these lines to get these images? Because I saw this image like horizontal lines, so I just get confused with this part.
I mean,
can you turn back to the slide?
Yeah,
they look horizontal, but they are actually vertical.
No, but
the slices are vertical.
The slices are vertical and the lines are actually horizontal. Because you see, you only get one line.
Yeah, and then you transpose, combine them together and transpose.
You don't have to transpose it. Because if all the standstill, this pixel, for example, the pixel I, will have the same value over time. And I'm putting the slices one before the other, and then the pixel I will have a continuous line if it's.
So you keep the pixel location the same as the
yeah.
Okay.
That's why these are under an experiment in the lab. These mm-hmm. are. So you saw the setup there.
Yep.
And,
you can go around to someone else.
Anyone else, or we go back? Okay, you go on.
Okay, I'm back in line again. So if I recall this right, you're making the activity image of the speckle pattern, and then you're applying the Gauss Laguerre transform to that to look for phase singularities in that image. What about in, and now if you look up there at a speckle pattern mm-hmm. itself, it's got, I mean basically wherever it's dark, mm-hmm. black, that's where the phase singularity
mm-hmm.
is. And have you applied the Gauss Laguerre transform to that to accentuate
yep.
those points, make it make sharper distinguishing points?
Yeah, and the problem is it won't work.
Mm-hmm.
Then the phase singularity density over the speckle pattern will remain the same because, as I told you before, this is an ergodic system, and if you don't move anything, just the location and the distribution.
Yeah, when it's averaged into this line. But still, I mean, I think it might be useful just to apply it to those images.
But the phase singularity will not be the same, but its density will be statistically the same.
I want to mention two applications that you might look into that are pretty
yeah,
interesting.
Sure.
Currently, there's a really big push among a group of soft matter scientists to study active networks, like cell cytoskeletons,
mm-hmm.
and how they and so they actually can make them in a petri dish. And they actually are doing all kinds of correlation studies of the dynamics of those to learn about how active matter works. They have all these fancy correlation techniques they use to get the techniques, but this might aid that. The other thing to think about is there's lots of singularities, I guess you could call them phase singularities in liquid crystals, so you visualize them under polarization. Maybe you've already got the data you need, I don't know, but there's such interesting phase singularities with different types of disclinations that they have in there.
There's a lot of interest in these liquid crystal devices, as there are light modulators that
right.
can be from phase or intensity, and there is a huge work in obtaining Gaussian beams with by means of liquid crystals. Yeah, actually.
Right. They actually use them to actually make Gauss Laguerre beams.
Yep.
They actually transform a Gaussian beam
mm-hmm.
into a Gauss Laguerre beam with those liquid crystals, but actually looking at the pattern under a polarization microscope, there's all, if it's not perfectly aligned, you get all these basically singularities as well, these spiral singularities that are very beautiful.
Now I get you. It's actually interesting. It's not to use the LCD, but to characterize the LCD.
Characterize them and learn something about the dynamics of liquid crystal light going through a thermal transfer. As you heat it up, they might disappear.
It actually sounds really good.
Yeah, I think there'd be people of interest in both those areas. You should look at some of those papers and try to apply it to those.
The challenge is getting the data.
Yeah.
The interest he has in the paint is because his collaboration with the people in Argentina, they have a lot of data.
Well, I think a lot of that data is freely available from the authors if you wanted to look into that some more to broaden.
Absolutely.
But I think it's very interesting what you're doing.
Absolutely.
Other questions? Okay, I guess if you want to just chat a little bit, he'll be there. And thank you. And as I told you, next Friday, the next